Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the description box and also in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let's move on to the analysis of first news article. This editorial article is with reference to the radicalization that happens in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Recently, the new Chief of Defence Staff has mentioned that there has been a significant increase in radicalization, particularly among the young people in Kashmir. In this context, we'll discuss in brief about radicalization, then also with respect to the remarks made by the Chief of Defence Staff, and finally we'll see with respect to the editorial, which is based on the remarks made by the CDS. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this editorial article is highlighted here for your reference. When we say radicalization, it simply refers to a process where an individual is transformed from a moderate law-abiding citizen into an active, violent extremist. Some of their actions and their agenda will become offenses against the state, and therefore they are also considered as anti-state activities. There will also be indoctrination of violent thoughts, negative thoughts with respect to attaining some specific political ideology or agenda or social agenda or religious agenda. So radicalization is the process wherein someone is made to adopt or indoctrinated to adopt radical positions or extreme positions with respect to political, religious or social issues, and they may or may not work against the government. There are many factors by which an individual becomes susceptible or vulnerable to radicalization. These could be, you know, extremist influences, or it could be also personal events, traumatic events, or national events, you know, some events that may happen at the national level or global level. Even that are known to influence an individual to adopt a radical position. Or the person could have been recently converted his or her religious affiliation or political affiliation. And identity confusion is also a factor that may lead to vulnerability. Then conflict with family over the religious beliefs or lifestyle choices or having extreme political views. These are also factors that may contribute to vulnerability. And if a person is victim or witness to a hate crime, either by race or religion or caste, even they are prone to radicalization. And because of pressure from peers, these peers are those who are associated with extremism. So friendship or closeness with peers who are associated with extremism is also a reason. Then again, if a particular person is rejected by family or social group or, you know, religious congregation or also among peer, then this particular person is also vulnerable. Persons who have underachieved in life, then they can become vulnerable. If a particular youth, if they possess literature that are related to extreme views and ideologies, that can also lead to radicalization. Experience of poverty or social exclusion, even these factors can influence a particular person, making the person as a vulnerable person to this radicalization process. Now the problem with radicalization is that here they will adopt violent means that can be detrimental to the state and also to the people who live in the state. So it will affect India's internal security. And radicalization is also considered as the first step towards extremism, particularly violent extremism. They adopt extreme political or social or religious ideals and aspirations. And if there is an opportunity, and in some cases even if there is not, they will not hesitate to perpetrate violence. So thereby, this becomes a great threat to India's internal security. And here, with respect to radicalization, the most vulnerable with respect to age are the younger generation. And then people who face unemployment or underemployment and who go through different conditions of life, when they could be radicalized. However, if you come to Kashmir, the radicalization here is largely based on religious lines with respect to adoption of radical Islamic ideology. So this is about the radicalization and the factors that leads to the vulnerability. Now let's come to the editorial. Recently, the CDS has made a statement in a panel discussion in the 5th edition of Raisina Dialogue. The panel discussion was with respect to countering terrorism. Here, as a speaker, the CDS has made a statement that children as young as 10 to 12 years are being radicalized in Kashmir. And this radicalization process happened in schools, universities, religious places and sites. He spoke about de-radicalization camps. This statement was considered as controversial statement or important statement because the CDS has acknowledged that India has de-radicalization camps. Now coming to Raisina Dialogue, this Raisina Dialogue is India's flagship geopolitical and geostrategic conference that happens every year since 2016. It's an annual event or annual conference that is hosted by Ministry of External Affairs of Government of India in partnership with an independent think tank called as Observer Research Foundation. Experts from various walk of life, political, social, academic, journalism, and also from student community, they also participate in this Raisina Dialogue. And recently this dialogue happened in New Delhi from 14th to 16th January with the theme 21st Century at 2020, Navigating the Alpha Century. So the statement made by CDS was in one of the panel discussion of this Raisina Dialogue. Now the editorial article states that when we compare the present situation to 1990s, terrorism and violence has reduced drastically in the last 10 years. And also in the last 10 years, there is an increased participation in democratic processes in the Kashmir Valley. And the radicalization process was also less in the last 10 years. However, in the last 3-4 years, there has been increase in protests and violence in the Kashmir Valley. The author states that this is because of the disaffection against the Indian government, and very specifically the recent abrogation of special status of Jammu and Kashmir, and also the conversion of state of Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories. We know that this happened in the month of August last year. And because of this move, many of the political leaders who are followed by the people of Jammu and Kashmir are kept under detention even till now. So when the situations are so tense and when their political leaders are in detention, the author states that the radicalism will further increase in Jammu and Kashmir, and it can either be in the form of separatism or it may lead to extremist Islamist ideology that may lead to anti-state activities or terrorism activities. Here when we say separatism, we are referring to the situation where people of Jammu and Kashmir, some part of radicalized youths, may demand separation of Jammu and Kashmir from India. They may even ask to join with Pakistan also. So that is the level of indoctrination that is happening there. So the author here tells that with the recent state actions, here when we say state actions, we are referring to Indian government. So recent actions of Indian government that happened in Jammu and Kashmir. So with these happenings, the radicalization is likely to further increase. But having said that, there is definitely a need to counter radicalization at all levels. But this author, this editorial mentions that de-radicalization is essential, but it should not happen in the way as CDS has suggested. That is, it should not happen through de-radicalization camps. So when we say de-radicalization camps, it refers to a fact that young people will be separated, particularly according to the statement made by CDS, children of 10 to 12 years of age. So these youths, adolescents, they will be separated from their family and community, from their mainstream society, and they will be kept in camps. So here the consequences is that they will be further alienated from their society, from their parents, and it may lead to public revulsion. That is, if their children are taken to de-radicalization camps, it may further increase the dissatisfaction of the Indian government among the aggrieved people of Jammu and Kashmir. And further, these de-radicalization camps, if at all they are to be set up, they should not be under the control of any armed forces. So the author states that handling the camps by armed forces would become completely illegal. This is because de-radicalization process is a mandate of agencies of civilian state, not the mandate of army or security forces. If you go with the letter and spirit of Juvenile Justice Act 2015, army or security forces should not handle children, particularly children who are living in a disturbed area. So what way this de-radicalization should happen? The author states that it can be achieved in a best manner by effective teaching and by incorporating civic duties in the school curriculum for children. And then there has to be outreach from the administration side to the citizens, asking them not to yield themselves to the radical demands made by extremists, or they should not fall trap to the persuasion of extremists. An editorial suggests that some repressive actions should not be carried out or continued by administration anymore. Here, when we say repressive actions, we are referring to limiting internet access, detention of political representatives, and other such short-sighted or illiberal or authoritarian measures. This is because these measures would be counterproductive or harmful in the long run. So what can be a possible alternative? See, the administration should reach out to the aggrieved sections of people in Jammu and Kashmir to win their confidence. So a strategy has to be adopted, that is winning hearts and minds strategy in both short-term process and also in the long-term. In addition to this, we discussed various factors that lead to vulnerability of an individual to be transformed into a radical person. All these individual factors has to be specifically targeted. Measures have to be brought in to deal with such factors. One such thing is poverty, social exclusion, possession of literature related to extreme views. And we also saw even global or national events that could add trauma to a child or a young person. Therefore, this person may become a radical. Here, with respect to JNK, we can relate it to, you know, the ways and means in which the Article 370 was abrogated and the ways and means in which the special status were taken away from Jammu and Kashmir and the reorganization of Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories. All these factors could have been seen as traumatic events by these people in their lives. So all these things has to be collectively addressed by the government, with the aim and purpose of winning their hearts and minds to take them into confidence. And when they are going to deal with children, particularly of 10 years or 12 years, it should not be done by security forces or army or any other security related agencies. Rather, it has to be carefully dealt by child friendly agencies such as, you know, National Commission for Protection of Child Rights, Child Welfare Committee, persons who are involved in the work of child rights, psychologists, sociologists, pediatricians, criminologists. So these are various important stakeholders. They should participate in this process to de-radicalize the youth and children. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next article. This news article states that many decisions taken during the recent 2+2 dialogue between India and United States will be put into practice in this year 2020. The news article also mentions about an important network, an infrastructure network called as Blue Dot Network. We'll be seeing about this network in the analysis of this news article. The syllabus relevant for the analysis has been highlighted here for your reference. Before entering into the discussion with respect to this Blue Dot Network, we'll see in brief about 2+2 dialogue. So if you want to say what is the highest level institutional mechanism between India and United States that brings together the perspectives of both countries on various issues, it is the 2+2 dialogue. Various issues here relates to foreign policy. It includes defense and strategic issues as well. When we say 2+2, it means two members from India and two members from United States. Of the two members, one involves the Ministry of External Affairs, other involves the Ministry of Defense of both the countries. In terms of India, it includes Minister of External Affairs and the Defense Minister. For United States, it involves the Secretary of State and the Secretary of Defense. Now, this 2+2 dialogue is a platform that is to provide a positive and forward-looking vision for the strategic partnership between India and United States. So far, we have heard two such 2+2 talks. First 2+2 dialogue was held in India in the year 2018. And the next year, that is last year, in December, it was held in the United States. While this is the case with respect to United States, we also have informal summit when it comes to China. And 2019 marked the second informal summit with China as well, which happened in Mamallapuram in Chennai. Anyhow, coming to United States, this news article states that in 2020, both India and US may establish a mechanism so as to fulfill or so as to implement various decisions taken during recent 2+2 talks that was held in December 2019. Here, when we say decisions, in the context of this news article, the decisions are particular with respect to defense and trade. During the recent 2+2 talks, both countries have agreed to promote on various fronts, you know, having a practical cooperation in infrastructure development, counter-terrorism, cyber security, also regional connectivity and various other important dimensions as well. So here you focus practical cooperation in infrastructure development, Now come to the news article, it mentions about a network called as Blue Dot Network. See, this is a network that is led by United States. The US have launched this Blue Dot Network in collaboration with Japan and Australia. Recently, at Bangkok in November 2019, this network was launched at the Indo-Pacific Business Forum. As we saw, this was jointly launched by United States, Australia and Japan. In terms of United States, it is taken care by Overseas Private Investment Corporation. In terms of Australia, it is Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade. In case of Japan, it is Japan Bank of International Cooperation. And coming to the ambition of this Blue Dot Network, it is to promote high quality global infrastructure development. And for promoting such a development, it aims to bring governments, private sectors, and also civil societies. And such a development is to be achieved through an open and inclusive framework. Now, this Blue Dot Network has some sort of ratings mechanism wherein the infrastructure projects in Indo-Pacific region and various other parts of the world will be graded. And this Blue Dot Network also aims to set standards for global infrastructure development. And such a development has to be based on market-driven approach, open and inclusive framework. And the infrastructure has to be socially and environmentally responsive and should be financially sustainable and also with transparency and accountability. According to diplomats and experts on international relations, they are saying that this Blue Dot Network is the effort of United States to counter the Belt and Road Initiative of China. Particularly recently in the year 2019, many nations have complained about this Belt and Road Initiative of China because initially many small nations considered BRI initiative as a great initiative for infrastructure development. However, it was found to be a debt trap initiative of China. And there were a lot of issues with respect to transparency and accountability, etc. Now, with the launch of Blue Dot Network, many countries who have concerns with respect to BRI may shift their allegiance from BRI to Blue Dot Network to improve the standards in global infrastructure projects. And the news article mentions that the United States may also convince India to join this Blue Dot Network, and most probably India may also join this Blue Dot Network in the future, and that will play a very important role in the relations between India and United States. Know that India is not a member of China's Belt and Road Initiative primarily because of the reason that the CPEC corridor, that is China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, which is an arm of this Belt and Road Initiative, passes through Indian territory of Jammu and Kashmir. Particularly, it passes through the territory which was handed over by Pakistan to China in 1963-64, but the handed over territory is an Indian territory, so India opposes to this Belt and Road Initiative. So these are some of the information with reference to the 2+2 dialogue mechanism between India and United States and the Blue Dot Network. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article states that India's telecommunications satellite named as GSAT-30 was successfully launched into a geosynchronous transfer orbit yesterday. And this GSAT-30 is the first mission of India for this year, 2020. It was launched from Kourou launch base in French Guiana through an European heavy lift launch vehicle. Now, this Kourou launch base in French Guiana, which is in northern part of South America, which is located in almost northeast in the South America, is the launch base used by European Space Agency and French Space Agency. So in the context of this news article, we'll see about GSAT-30, geosynchronous orbit, geostationary orbit, geosynchronous transfer orbit, and also few differences between GSLV Mark II of India and GSLV Mark III of India. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. See, this geosynchronous satellite 30 or GSAT-30 is a communication satellite of India. It aims to provide communication services from geostationary orbit in C and Q bands. The weight is around 3,300 kilograms and the purpose is to replace INSAT-4 capital A spacecraft. And this GSAT-30 is expected to give enhanced coverage than INSAT-4A. This satellite is expected to provide services to the entire Indian territory, including the island regions ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள் அந்தமான் நிக்கோபார், லக்ஷத்வீப் எக்ஸெட்ரா. த GZ-30 கேன் ஆல்சோ ப்ரொவைட் எக்ஸ்டெண்டட் கவரேஜ் டு கல்ஃப் கண்ட்ரீஸ் அண்ட் நம்பர் ஆஃப் ஏஷியன் கண்ட்ரீஸ் அண்ட் ஆல்சோ ஆஸ்திரேலியா. த மிஷன் லைஃப் ஆஃப் திஸ் GZ-30 இஸ் 15 இயர்ஸ். ஸோ தீஸ் ஆர் சம் ஆஃப் த இன்ஃபர்மேஷன் வித் ரெஃபரன்ஸ் டு GZ-30. நவு லெட் சி வித் ரெஸ்பெக்ட் டு ஜியோ சின்க்ரோனஸ் ஜியோ ஸ்டேஷனரி ஜியோ சின்க்ரோனஸ் டிரான்ஸ்பர் ஆர்பிட்ஸ். Now, we usually place communication satellites at an altitude of 36,000 kilometers from the Earth's surface. We are keeping the satellites at this much altitude so as to minimize the pull of gravity of Earth. So what happens when we place satellites closer to Earth or in lower altitudes? Because of the pull of gravity, the satellite moves more quickly. Thereby, communication satellites, they may not be able to deliver the services as required. So the lower the satellite's orbit, the quicker is the movement of the satellite. The higher a satellite's orbit, the slower will be its movement. So when the satellite reaches about 36,000 kilometers from the Earth's surface, it enters a sweet spot where the orbit of the satellite matches with the rotation of the Earth. This is because the satellite at this particular orbit moves at the same speed with the rotation of the Earth. So in a geosynchronous orbit, this orbit which is at 36,000 kilometers above the Earth's surface is called as geosynchronous orbit, where the satellite seems to be staying in a particular place over a single longitude, though at this latitude it may drift north to south. This high Earth orbit is called as geosynchronous orbit. Now, when this circular geosynchronous orbit is directly over the equator, then this geosynchronous orbit is called as geostationary orbit. Here there is no movement at all for the satellites that are placed in geostationary orbit. Now, being in a geostationary orbit, the satellite will be always directly over the same place on the Earth's surface. So this is about geostationary orbit. And because geostationary satellites are always over a single location, they can be very useful for communication purposes. And also many weather satellites also tend to have high Earth orbit far from the Earth's surface. So the news is that as of now, GZ-30 satellite was launched into a geosynchronous transfer orbit. Now, as the name implies, it is a transfer orbit, that is, to attain geosynchronous or geostationary Earth orbit, first a spacecraft is launched into an elliptical orbit, which is at an altitude of around 37,000 km from the Earth's surface. From here, the spacecraft will be moved to geostationary or geosynchronous orbit. The news article mentions that the GZ-30, we didn't launch using GSLV Mark II, and we also did not use GSLV Mark III for the launch of GZ-30, even though it has the payload capability. Now see, GSLV Mark II is a three-stage vehicle. Now coming to the differences between GSLV Mark II and GSLV Mark III, see, both are three-stages vehicle. Now because the payload capacity is higher with respect to GSLV Mark III, it is called as three-stage heavy lift launch vehicle. Now in case of GSLV Mark II, the first stage has a solid rocket motor, which is supported by four liquid strap-on motors. The second stage is a liquid stage. The third stage is cryogenic upper stage. Now, in case of GSLV Mark III, the first stage is solid stage, as GSLV Mark III uses two solid rocket boosters or strap-ons. Then the core stage or the second stage is a liquid stage. And the third stage is cryogenic upper stage, where the fuel is liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen. Now, with respect to payload capacity, GSLV Mark II can take payloads of 2,500 kg to geosynchronous transfer orbit and a payload of around 5,000 kg to low Earth orbit. In case of Mark III, it can take a payload of 4,000 kg to geosynchronous transfer orbit and 8,000 kg to low Earth orbits. We didn't opt for GSLV Mark II because the satellite is around 3,300 kilogram. And though we had potential to use GSLV Mark III to carry the payload of around 3,300 kilogram, we didn't use it because we reserved the GSLV Mark III launch vehicles for the purpose of unmanned trial missions with respect to Gaganyaan first human spaceflight mission. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next article. This news article is about a petition that is filed in Supreme Court with respect to non-implementation of National E-Mobility Mission Plan 2020. In this context, we'll be discussing few information with respect to this National Electric Mobility Mission Plan. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. See this National Electric Mobility Mission Plan 2020. It's a national mission document which provides vision and roadmap for faster adoption of electric vehicles and also their manufacturing in India. It aims to transform the entire automotive and transportation industry in the country by the adoption of electric and hybrid vehicles. So as a result, this plan is designed to enhance national fuel security and to provide affordable transportation, to provide environmental friendly transportation, and also to enable Indian automotive industry to achieve global manufacturing leadership, particularly with respect to electric or hybrid vehicles. This mission document is based on the initiatives taken by the Department of Heavy Industry, which comes under Ministry of Heavy Industries and Public Enterprises. The mission aims to promote hybrid and electric mobility in India through a combination of policies and schemes. The aim is that to achieve a vehicle population of 6 to 7 million electric or hybrid vehicles in India by the year 2020. And this has to be carried out along with certain level of indigenization of technology so as to ensure India's global leadership in some vehicle segments with respect to electric or hybrid vehicles. Now, this mission has five important aspects. One is to provide demand-side incentives to facilitate acquirement or acquisition of hybrid or electric vehicles. Then to promote research and development in technology. Here, technology refers to battery technology, power electronics, motors, system integration, battery management system, etc. And the mission also aims to promote charging infrastructure. And one of the important aspects is to provide supply side incentives and also to encourage retrofitting of on-road vehicles with hybrid kit. For example, the present day vehicles can be altered a little so as to ensure that the vehicles can act as a hybrid or electric vehicle. So there may not be a requirement of purchase of a complete electric or hybrid vehicle. For which this National Electric Mobility Mission Plan is a basis is the FAME India scheme. So as part of this mission plan of 2020 only, the Department of Heavy Industry formulated this faster adoption and manufacturing of hybrid and electric vehicles in India scheme in the year 2015. So the scheme aims to promote manufacturing of electric and hybrid vehicle technology and also to ensure sustainable growth of the manufacturing of such vehicles. It has two phases, phase 1, phase 2. Phase 1 was from 2015 to 2019 and phase 2 is from 2019 to 2022. We have discussed the FAME India scheme in detail on our analysis on January 2. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to the practice questions discussion session. Now we have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. Now this question is with reference to Blue Dot Network. They have given two statements. They are asking which of the following statements are incorrect. The first statement, BDN initiative is to bring governments, private sectors and civil societies for promoting high quality global infrastructure development. Now this statement is correct. But the question asks for incorrect statements. So the first statement being a correct statement should not be in the options. So you can eliminate option A and option C. Now come to the second statement. The network was launched during the first 2+2 dialogue in November 2019 at Washington DC in collaboration with Japan and Australia. See, this BDN initiative is a US-led initiative which was launched in collaboration with Japan and Australia in November 2019, but not during the 2+2 dialogue between India and United States. And in fact, the recent 2+2 dialogue between India and United States was held at United States in December 2019, and it is not the first 2+2 dialogue between India and United States. It is actually the second 2+2 dialogue. However, it is the first 2+2 dialogue to be held on American soil because the 2+2 dialogue had its debut in India in the year 2018. So this BDN network was launched in November 2019 with a collaboration from Japan and Australia at the Indo-Pacific Business Forum at Bangkok. So the second statement is incorrect. Question asks for incorrect statements. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 only. Now this question is with reference to GSLV launch vehicles. They have given two statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, GSLV Mark 3 has a payload capacity of 8,000 kg to geosynchronous transfer orbit and 4,000 kg to low earth orbits of 600 km altitude. Now this statement is incorrect because the Mark 3 has payload capacity of 4000 kilogram to GTO and 8000 kilogram to low earth orbits of 600 kilometer altitude. So since the first statement is incorrect, you can eliminate option A and option C. Now come to the second statement. Both GSLV Mark 3 and GSLV Mark 2 launch vehicles are three-stage launch vehicles. Now this statement is correct. This is because both are three-stage launch vehicles. But GSLV Mark 3 has better specifications with respect to payload capacity, because Mark 2 has the payload capacity of 2500 kilogram to GTO and 5000 kilogram to low earth orbit. The third stage of both these launch vehicles are cryogenic upper stage, and the center stage or the second stage of both these launch vehicles are liquid stage, that is, they use liquid fuel. However, there is a difference with respect to the first stage, because in GSLV Mark II, the first stage has a solid rocket motor supported or augmented by four liquid strap-on motors. Whereas in GSLV Mark III, the first stage uses only solid rocket boosters. There are two solid rocket boosters. So the correct answer for this question is option B, two only. Now this question is with reference to National Electric Mobility Mission Plan. Consider the following statements regarding National Electric Mobility Mission Plan 2020. Two statements are given. They're asking which of the statements given above are correct. First statement, the mission aims at fast adoption of electric vehicles, their manufacturing in the country, and enabling Indian automotive industry to achieve global manufacturing leadership. This statement is correct. So you can eliminate option B and option D. The second statement, the vision is to achieve total sales of 6 to 7 million hybrid or electric vehicles by the year 2022. See, hybrid and electric vehicles, they are also denoted as XEVs. See, the mission plan is for 2020, but the statement is with respect to 75th year of Indian independence. The second statement is incorrect because the vision is to achieve total sales of 6 to 7 million hybrid or electric vehicles by the year 2020. So the correct answer here is option A, one only. Now see this mains question. This is for practice. Define and discuss radicalization in the context of Jammu and Kashmir. Do you think de-radicalization camps, as suggested by India's Chief of Defense Staff, is a solution to reduce the radical tendencies among the children and the youth of Jammu and Kashmir? Now you may write answers for this question and take a photograph or convert it to PDF and upload it into your drive, and in the sharing settings you make it as share the link so that anyone with the link can view, and copy the link in the comment section, and we will give you appropriate feedback within some 7 to 10 working days. So with this we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil services exam preparation.